So thanks a lot again for being here and for staying at the continuation of our event today. So this is the following plan. Basically, I will first introduce a short video. We look at it, and after that, we will start immediately with our panel. And this video is done by Dries Depoorter, that is a digital artist from Belgium. He actually will introduce himself, so I don't need to say too much, but I also wanted to tell you a bit about the context of this and why we are actually showing this video. So then I met Dries like 1 month ago during the Retune Festival, and actually I want to thank the people of this festival because they organized a really funny curator bus tour in which we were all a bunch of curators and a bunch of artists in this bus going around for Berlin, around Berlin with the idea of meeting each other. And so in this situation, you never know what is going to happen. But at the end, I met this guy, Dries. And unfortunately, it was really late for our program, so I could not invite him here. But nevertheless, I thought that was nice to have his contribute because it was really fitting with the discourse we are doing of truth-telling. And actually, he was having another perspective that I wanted to bring in this context because he's an artist that is stretches the limits of truth-telling because basically he decided to live in total transparency since long time. For example, he was telling me that he created a program that is sharing online one screenshot a day of his computer. So basically, he's doing his stuff at the computer and suddenly there is a screenshot and this is shared online. And at the same time also, he's always giving the exact location and direction with another software that is using Google Street View of his position. And at the beginning, I was really surprised because I say, sorry, why are you doing that? I mean, we are all advocating privacy and you are basically giving away your life. And so he had really an interesting discussion. And then I understood that his point of view was basically doing the other round. So trying to stretch the limit of truth-telling by basically showing that there was no place to hide, by using also the title of the book that we know. And so I asked him to create this short video for us about two installations that he did. One is called Seattle Crime Crimes and the other Jaywalking. And with the Seattle Crime Crimes, he's basically exploiting the fact that Seattle is a city that also advocates certain crazy surveillance transparency on the people. So basically all the police calls are connected online, and at the same time also all the surveillance camera could be connected with that. So he will explain that better. And also with Jaywalking, he created an installation based on a software that scans traffic lights and also check whether the light is red or green and spots anyone braving the red light and jaywalking. And so the people can either report to the police or not. But I think that in a sense, we will watch now the video, and also his interesting aesthetic that he's using, and I think is a good introduction for our panel as well.
My name is Dries Depoorter. I'm a media artist living in Ghent in Belgium. Thank you for the invite, but sorry I could not be there tonight. And mostly my work is about privacy, surveillance and online identity. And tonight I'm going to talk about a project named Share of Software, and it exists out of two installations. One is named Jaywalking and the other one is named Seattle Crime Camps. Let's have a look.
The first one, Seattle Crime Camps, tries to show you real-time crime in Seattle. In Seattle, they share the location of the latest police caller. Also, they have a lot of surveillance webcams, and the installation shows you the closest surveillance webcams around the location of the latest police caller in Seattle, and it tries to show you in real time crime. The other installation that I made is named Jaywalking. It's an interactive installation where you see three monitors showing real-time surveillance webcams pointed to crossroads. One is in the Netherlands, the other one is in New York, and it shows crossroads. And software is running and checking if people are walking through a red light. It uses simple computer vision software where it detects a traffic light, and then if the traffic light shows red, detects if someone crossing the road. If the computer detects a jaywalker, you get this question: would you like to report the jaywalker? The visitor of the installation can then press the red button to report the jaywalker, and the system sends an email to the closest police station around the surveillance webcam.
This was the interactive installation, but currently I'm also working on a project where the software is running on my computer, detecting jaywalkers all over the world using live surveillance webcams. And I save, if the system detects a jaywalker, it saves it as an image, and I put them in a photo frame. If you want to buy this photo frame, you pay the same price as the fine in that country, as the ticket in that country. So the money doesn't go to police, but it goes to me. Thank you for listening. Thank you for inviting me, and have a good night.
So now we start with our panel, and please don't leave me here alone. I will call the next speakers, Jack Werner, that is a journalist from Sweden, Hans Bernhard from the UBERMORGEN artist group, and Carmen Weisskopf and Doma Smoljo from the Mediengruppe Bitnik. And the title, as you can see, is Beyond Evidence. So thank you very much. So I would just like to do a kind of short introduction, because I think that, I mean, we are already a lot of people on stage, and I really want to hear what they're going to tell us this evening. So this is basically the last part of these events, and in a sense also the more, if you want, speculative part, because when I was trying to conceptualize a bit this conference, I thought that by speaking about truth-telling, first of all, we have also the responsibility of questioning the concept of truth itself. And in a sense, this is not something new, because if people know the history of art and activism in internet since, I would say, the 80s and even before, then the concept of the truth was often investigating a question by many people. For example, I mean, just if we mention, for example, Luther Blissett, or even before, from San Francisco, the Cacophony Society. Actually, we have exactly last year in our last conference some people speaking about that. And I think that even is a discourse that is complicated to do because, of course, now that people say we are in the post-truth, even if I don't believe, I totally share with Grace and the others the idea that the truth actually is difficult to define it as post. I think that, as I say, we have the responsibility also to understand what this concept means, because we also know that there is never only a single truth, but aspects and subject can be really analyzed from different perspectives. And I think, in a sense, because also we work with art and information and media, we have also this responsibility to understanding how, for example, internet culture work, and also analyze and investigate these more obscure parts of the internet that we could actually access. And I think, in a sense, I want to reconnect with the pre-events that we had at this conference, that was at the Spectrum space, November 11, in which we invited also Gabriel Moses to speak. And he did a really interesting performative talk about the discourse of lie-able art. So we were really reflecting also why actually a person like Trump won today. I mean, what does it mean to be so able to play with the truth and also use social media and communication in a way in which then you can reach a success by also demonstrating that truth is something totally questionable. And so I am really happy to have here the people that for a long time have been investigating this obscure part of the internet and also the meaning of the truth, and also the importance of the sources, for example, in journalism. And I would like first to start with Jack Werner. I want to introduce you briefly. He's the author of the book Creepypasta, Ghost Stories from the Internet, and actually I was really intrigued to understand what these creepypasta are, and I think then we will ask him, actually. When I approach his work, I end up also reading a lot about this discourse of fake lore, like the combination between fake and folklore, that I think is really interesting definition, because is also asking us to wonder and investigate, for example, the impact and meaning of viral storytelling, also what the sources of information are and mean, both in journalism and in media culture. So now I leave the word to him. And by the way, I think there was something interesting you wrote that I want to report, that you wrote that you are probably, or I don't know if you wrote, but somebody, that you are the most important journalist in Sweden right now. So I really like that. And I think that with that, we can pass the word to you.
Thank you. And I can't comment on the credibility of that last part. I might as well start off by addressing the thing about post-truth that has been sort of a running joke almost during this event, because post-truth is of course a very strange way of explaining what is going on right now. It was elegantly addressed yesterday, as we have been talking about already, but I can also report that there is actually research that shows that facts does work. I mean, if you do political fact-checking, it does have an effect on the people reading it. And in Sweden, a lot of journalists are talking about the concept called facts resistance, which means that you're, of course, then resistant to facts. And it's a concept invented by journalists, and sometimes I get the feeling that the journalist invented that concept because they're tired of people not caring about what they're writing about. So it's like a way of saying, we're doing all this hard work and all of these peasants just don't care. The problem must be that they are sick in some way. And a modest question could be, have you thought about doing better work? That could be a solution to the issue. But so with that out of the way, I'd like to start off by talking about mass hysteria, because as we have also been talking about previously, the concept of truth is of course very gnarly and it's hard to understand. And sometimes truth shows itself in a sort of unexpected way. And the two pictures up here are two examples of recent mass hysterias. The one to the left is that time in 1999, when all of a sudden hundreds of students in Belgium started to throw up and be violently ill because they had been drinking Coca-Cola. And Coca-Cola handled this very bad. They all said, no, there can't be a problem. All our cans are okay. And then they had to recall hundreds of thousands of cans because they, you know, got nervous. And people were sick for a couple of weeks, and then they weren't sick anymore. And doctors made evaluations, and they were there were a lot of investigating what had happened. And a couple of months later, they all came to the conclusion that this was a mass hysteria. There was no problem with the Coca-Cola cans or the Coca-Cola bottles. But it started off with one person being sick after drinking Coca-Cola, then all of a sudden a lot of people were sick. The picture to the right is from a Finnish newscast in the 90s as well, in which it started off by one person saying, I have seen a lion in the forest in Finland. And a lot of people followed suit and said that, yes, I as well have seen a lion in the forest. And let me again stress, in Finland. And this was a matter for the news for weeks. For weeks people talked about this lion, and they also found tracks in the snow, because this was in the snow, in the forest of Finland. And you know, in the end, they all came to the conclusion that there was, of course, no fucking lion in the forest in Finland, and the tracks were just made up. So, I mean, yet another mass hysteria. And why am I talking about this? Well, because of the scary clowns. Did you hear about the scary clowns? I guess you did. This was a big matter in the Swedish news a couple of weeks ago. And if you managed to miss this, if so, I'm very envious. If you managed to miss this, the story started off by one person reporting a scary clown on the streets of some city in South Carolina in the US. And then through social media, images and movies of scary clowns and reports of being scary clowns being witnessed all over the US, it spread all through the at least 37 states, as far as I've heard. And then it jumped over the Atlantic. And all of a sudden, people in all of Europe, and not to mention Sweden, started reporting these scary clowns. And the first thing I noticed while reading about the clowns was in Swedish media, as well as in German media, the images chosen to depict the scary clowns. I don't know if you see this, but these are very scary clowns indeed. The images used. That's a scary clown, that is a creepy clown, and that is a murderous clown. The words used as well is horror clown, murderous clown. I mean, there was no limits to the words used and to the pictures used. And when media starts to write about something as if it was a real life horror movie, it's not strange that people reading that think that, all right, we're living in a real life horror movie. That's not a strange effect. So what happened was that people started writing about the clowns on social media, and this is just one screen cap of one Facebook status, but what it says is basically, I'm seeing reports from school principals and various other sources that there are alleged clown sightings now happening in our area. Blah, blah, blah has seen two sightings close to us. I've heard this too, definitely creepy. I mean, people all over Facebook were writing about alleged clown sightings. Very few people were writing about clown sightings they had made. And I have done a couple of presentations on critical thinking and media literacy in schools since this all happened, because that's part of my job. And I've been, you know, in front of 300 students in the age of 16, and I have asked them, how many of you have heard about the clowns? Every single one have raised their hands. And then I've asked, how many of you have seen a clown? To which three have raised their hands, and they've all been giggling a whole lot. I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying that generally kids aren't very good witnesses. I don't know if you remember the witch process in Salem in the US, or the witch process in Sweden for that matter in the 1600s. A lot of kids reported a lot of witches and they were all burned. I'm not sure about if all of those women were witches, or even if they should be burned if they were witches. Being witches is cool. which everybody who has ever seen Buffy the Vampire Slayer knows. So a lot of reports on clowns, a very little substance in the reports. This is another interesting part of the clown hysteria. This is an article that could have been published this year. Children Frightened, a clown appears on the grounds of Drury Academy. It's just that it's published in 1896. And this was just the first media mention of clown hysteria that I could find. There has been a lot since. Just during the 80s, there were about 25 clown hysterias in the North Americas alone. This is not an isolated case. This is the continuum of a very long-running story that we have been telling for a long time. It has to do partly with, his name is Gacy, right? The murderer? Something Gacy, am I correct? John Wayne Gacy, there you go. John Wayne Gacy, a serial killer who was very well known, partly because he also part-time worked as a clown on kids' parties, on birthday parties, which is not a very good activity to combine with serial killing. He kind of gave a face to the whole clown fright and the whole clown scare, and made the whole story bigger in the 80s. And we have a similar thing in Sweden, in which every now and again on Facebook, you'll see a Facebook status saying, watch out for the white van. A white van is going around, and it contains either Polish people who's going to break into your house, or whatever, Hungarian people going to take your kids, or, you know, people from Mars going to take your dog. And those stories can be tracked down to a killer in Belgium, Mark Dutroux, who actually went around with a white van as well, and who sort of, after that incident, it was all of a sudden a lot more reports coming out about killers in white vans. So these, you know, the big news stories have an impact on us. We start to see what we read about in big news stories all around us. That's becoming a part of our lives. And my interest in all this is that if we start to view fake news as folklore, as a way of us expressing our fears, expressing what we don't understand, expressing what we're trying to understand, what we worry about. If we see fake stories as sort of folklore, then we get to learn a whole lot more from the stories. And then, you know, because what we do right now is we just, you know, we push the stories aside. We stamp them with the word fake and we say this has nothing to do in the discourse. We push them aside instead of learning from them. What I do in my work is that I run a podcast on ghost stories, which for some strange reason have become Sweden's 10 biggest podcast, and it's just me telling ghost stories. It's very weird. So I do that with my part-time, and then part-time I do stuff like this. I talk about media literacy and critical thinking in schools. So I combine ghost stories with media literacy and critical thinking. I don't combine it in one sitting. A ghost story shouldn't be opened up with a discourse on critical thinking. But this is what I do. And what happened when the creepy clowns came to Sweden was that people, journalists, started to contact me asking, where does this story come from? Why are we talking about creepy? Where does the creepy clown thing come from? And I had to tell them all, that's a lousy question. I can't answer that because I have to go back 120 years in time. And that's not useful to you. What you should ask me is, why do we talk about the clowns right now? What's the deal? Why do we talk about the story? And I have actually a thought about that, which is that, I'm not sure if it showed up in this Facebook status, but if I see a clown, there will be nothing left of your clowny ass bullshit, but shreds of bad clown wig and cheap makeup smears on the pavement. I will cut a clown. Which is pretty aggressive, seeing that you're talking about a clown, which is not a mythological creature. I mean, we're all talking, and that goes through in this as well. Horror clowns, 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 clowns. No one's mentioning that these are 15-year-olds who's dressed up in very fake and very bad costumes. That's what it is. They're writing about this as if it was some kind of minotaur or dragon, something that came straight out of, you know, Lord of the Rings, which is not. This is people dressed up. And then people are starting to talk about this in a very violent, aggressive way. Why are they doing that? Well, part of the reason is that I think there are a big feeling of unrest, distrust, and fear in Europe right now. We have left a year in which there has been a lot of worry for a lot of reasons. Last year was filled with terror attacks. These are not very good times in that sense. Still, the fact of the matter is that most central numbers when it comes to how good we are doing are going up. We're doing better and better. The world is actually looking better and better. So there is a sort of, it doesn't go together, our feeling of how afraid we are of the world and how good we actually are doing. And a lot of people are talking about this, especially about immigrants, you know, and especially during this last year, about them as a threat, because they perceive something as a threat. Something is threatful in their world, and then they perceive the immigrants as a threat because that's the closest thing they come to a threat. So they're talking about immigrants as a threat, and they start mobs. In Sweden, we have seen a few racist mobs actually organizing and patrolling the streets. And this feeling of worry and this feeling of fear actually has impacted more people than just the people organizing in racist mobs. But they are not saying that I'm afraid and if you come here, I will beat you, I will, you know, cut your ass, whatever. They don't say that, because if they say that, people reading will, you know, connect them with the racist mobs, which they don't want to be connected to. And then all of a sudden the clowns show up. And the clowns give everybody a neutral reason to say, I will kill you if you come here because you are objectively evil. It's all of a sudden, you get to blow off some steam. You get to say, I will protect what is mine against an unknown force, an unknown threat. So in that sense, you can read the clowns as us blowing off some steam in a time of big worry, in a time of big fear. I have an example of just how a story like this can change during 50 years. And this is a song from a CD that I listened a lot to when I was a kid. It was called like Swedish Golden Memories and something like that. It was a lot of humor from the 50s and 60s, a lot of sketches and, you know, jokes. And a lot of them were very, very dated, but I was a geek and not very cool. So I thought it was hilarious to joke about kings that had been dead for 40 years when I heard this. Like, oh, Gustav the Fifth. So anyway, on this CD, there was this song. Dear John, performed by Charles Norman and Alice Babs. And it was about a guy who did the military service in the 50s. And the thing is that this is based on an English version, so I can actually give you just a taste of what the song was like. Dear John, oh how I hate to write. Dear John, I must let you know tonight that my love for you has died away like grass upon the lawn. And tonight I wed another, dear John. And so it's about this guy doing the military service, and he's... No. That's not why I'm here. Thank you, but that's not the reason to applaud. He's doing the military service. He writes a whole lot of letters home to his girlfriend. He says, I love you, I love you, I love you. She writes lesser and lesser mails back. Then one day he gets a mail, he opens it up, he reads it, and it says, would you mind sending me the picture of me back that you have, because my new husband wants it. In today's vocabulary, we would probably call that a bitch move. So he, of course, becomes very sad because his girlfriend at home wants to leave him. He walks around on the military base, he tells all his friends about this, and they come up with a plan. They come up with a plan that they are going to gather all pictures of girls that they have and then put them in an envelope. And then he writes, please pick out the picture of you and send the rest back. I have forgotten what you look like. Yeah. So, signed, Dear John, your Dear John. A very good story. A very good story in the 50s in Sweden. Not to say the least, because in the 50s in Sweden, we had like 50 or 60,000 people doing the military service. Almost everybody had a sibling or a son or a brother, someone who's doing the military service. So we could connect to this story. You know, we could feel the tragedy, we could feel the sorrow and the pain in this guy who had made this sacrifice for his country in the way that the story was told and had been left by his girlfriend. Today, Sweden has an army that consists of, the last time I checked, it was 12 people, out of whom 3 are working in the kitchen. So we don't have that kind of groundwork to feel this story anymore. But a country that has that kind of groundwork to feel the story is, of course, the United States. And when I did my research for the book that you mentioned, my book on creepypasta, I found this picture, which is the exact same story, word for word, with one difference. It's about a Marine soldier, an American Marine soldier deployed to Afghanistan. And there is one more difference in the detail, a detailed difference, which is the girlfriend's letter. In the letter, she explained that she had slept with 2 guys while he had been gone and she wanted to break up with him. She has all of a sudden slept with 2 guys. In the original version, she just wanted to break up the engagement, marry another man. What has happened? Well, as a matter of fact, I do happen to have a theory. And that theory is that in this story, it is very important for us to like the guy and dislike the girl. Because if we don't, then the story falls. We need to like the guy and we need to, you know, sort of loathe the girl. And a trick that storytellers have known for centuries when it comes to making an audience disliking a girl is to depict her as a slut. If I, as a storyteller for hundreds of years, want to make a public hate a girl, then I just, you know, paint her out as a slut. And then you like her less. Sadly, it's a part of the society. And in the 50s, if you wanted to make out a girl to be a slut, then the only thing you had to say was that she's going to break up this engagement and marry another man. And then the audience would go, whoa, that's slutty. Today, though, if you want to make the same point, she has to sleep with 2 different guys, not planning to marry any one of them. So what we have found by just comparing these 2 stories to each other is a slut index that shows how our view of women and sexuality have changed during the latest 50 years, which to me is fascinating. Because these are just 2 stories among 100 million stories that are circulating on social media. To me, this is the best thing we can find in stories like this. Another example is, this is a text message that was published on Facebook in the fall of 2015. It started out by being sent around as a text. And then it was distributed on Facebook as well. Someone published it and it got a lot of shares. What this story is the person writing the text message writes as follows. My relative is working in the criminal department, whatever, in Sweden, and they recently arrested an ISIS member. And I reckon he had the ISIS membership card or something, because otherwise I don't know how you just say, like, you're a member. But anyway, so they arrested an ISIS member, and they were going to extradite him. But before he was going to be extradited, you know, it took a couple of weeks in the system, he was interrogated, stuff like that. Then the last day came, he was about to be extradited, but before he said to the relative of this text message writer, I want to talk to you. So the ISIS member and this relative sits down in a room, which cannot be cool, and the ISIS member says, you've been nice to me during the latest weeks, so I want to give you an advice. Don't be in Gothenburg during Christmas or New Year's Eve. All right, I'm done. And then he was extradited. And this was that was the story going around on Facebook and in text messages. And it was picked up by mainstream media in Sweden as well. Threat against Gothenburg circulating on social media. ISIS threat against Gothenburg spreading. Police calls for calm. Not very strange that this story was accepted the way it was, because this was very shortly after the attacks in Paris. So, I mean, we all had terrorism on our mind. And I've done this presentation for kids and students in Gothenburg as well, and they have come up after the presentation saying, yeah, we've read a lot about these ISIS members in Gothenburg in the news. So for us, this was completely to be expected, that, you know, something like this would happen. We do feel that Gothenburg is a realistic target for ISIS. For them, this story was very realistic. It wouldn't have been, though, if they had read some folklore. And it wouldn't have been for these journalists if these journalists just knew something about folklore. If they had read something about folklore, they would have known that in Australia, in the fall of 2001, in October, November, a story was circulating that said that a woman was walking around on the streets. Before her walked a man who looked Arabic. That was all that was said. He had an Arabic look. And he dropped his wallet. She picked it up. She said, "You dropped your wallet, man with an Arabic look." And the man said, "Yes, I am a man with an Arabic look. Thank you. As a thanks for this, I will give you an advice. Don't be in Sydney around Christmas or New Year's Eve." This was in October, November of 2001. If they had read some folklore, they would have known that this story has been passed around about members of the IRA in Northern Ireland. If they had read some folklore, they had known that this story was passed around in the end of the Second World War. If they had read some folklore, they would have known that this story was circulating in the end of the 1880s. This story is 130 years old. But as soon as we feel that kind of fright that only terrorism gives us, then this story is woken up again. And that's not strange in a way, because terrorism has as a goal, of course, it wants to make us feel unsafe. It wants to make us in this very room feel that we could be the next target. It could happen to us right now. And I mean, in that sense, terrorism kind of cuts our routines. It makes us not do stuff. It makes us not voice, you know, let our voices be heard. It sort of snips off a vital part of the democracy. So in that sense, terrorism is very faceless, and you know, as it has a target that wants us to become more quiet. And this story talks about how we perceive terrorism as something we cannot see, something we cannot articulate, and that's irritating. So we're giving the terrorism a face. By the terrorist who's, you know, taken by the criminal department in Sweden, who's threatening Gothenburg. Right, now terrorism has a face. Thanks a lot, I feel a whole lot better. It also tells us something about how naive we are. Because this story is built upon a terrorist saying to the criminal department, "This is my plan for my next terrorist move." Which is probably not what a good strategic terrorist would do. Just go and tell about his plans for the criminal department. So, I don't know how much time I have left, 5 minutes? All right, so let's run through this fast. This is Talking Angela. Is anybody acquainted with Talking Angela at all? No? Maybe your kids are, if you have them, because this is an iPhone app, or smartphone app rather, a chat bot, which means that you can sort of communicate with it. You write stuff to it, and it understands sort of what you're writing and writing something back. So it will say, "Hello, what's your name?" And then you will answer, "Lisa." And then it will say, "Good to meet you, Lisa. What, do you want to play a game?" So, you know, it kind of adopts what you're saying to the chatbot and uses it back to you. And you can play games and you can have some quizzes and, you know, it's a very nice and cozy app. Or that's what you can think, at least, that it's a very nice and cozy app. A couple of years ago, a rumor started circulating internationally about Talking Angela being hacked by a pedophile in Paris. Note a pedophile in Paris. One singular pedophile in Paris. There's an app called Talking Angela. Do not download it. There's a guy or guys, this says one singular pedophile in Swedish, who stalks children. This one girl on Twitter downloaded it, and Angela asked where she lived, but the girl lied, and Angela replied, "You lied." And then the girl's aunt address came up on the screen. Then she tried to log off, and Angela said, "I know where you're about to log off. Watch out, beautiful." The app also takes picture of you with your front camera. This guy is like a genius. Please don't download it and warn people. It's so scary. In the warning, there's also included pictures of how this hacker pedophile's silhouette is seen in the eye of Talking Angela. How you can see him through the phone. And this is interesting because, so, when I grew up, when I was a kid, what I always got to hear from my parents was that on the internet, never ever tell anybody your real name. Always be quiet about your real name. And then the first question this app asks, of course, is, "What is your name?" And then what you have is a sort of a cute cat, but it's, you know, it's falling between the completely fictional character and the very realistic character, and there's a very known scary sort of valley between those two extremes. So she's kind of scary in a way. So the kids, you know, they hear this question and they start to feel like, all right, this there might be a threat in this app. And then they're looking in their like archive about what could be a threat in an app. And all they've heard about is hackers and pedophiles. They don't know what either of those two are. They don't really know what a hacker is. They know that there's something who can take over your stuff, but nothing more than that. They don't luckily know what a pedophile is, most of them. They just know it's kind of an ugly, you know, some dirty old man. So, you know, when they try to construct this threat and give it sort of a face, it becomes a hacking pedophile. A very stressed out hacking pedophile, because this this app is downloaded on millions of phones, and this one guy in Paris has a very hectic schedule, if he's to go around, yeah, whatever. But also, it tells us something about the view, our view of the internet, because I'm usually doing this sort of comparison to from the internet to the forest. The forest 100 and 120 years ago was a very vital part of the world to us. We used it for our animals, we used it for wood, and we used it for, you know, we used it for stuff. But still, the forest was never entirely mapped. Behind every tree, there could be a threat. We knew about people who'd walked in, who'd walk into the forest and, you know, never come back. The forest was not our base. It was someone else's base. And what you have on the internet is almost the same thing. Because you do all your things there. You do all the, you know, banking stuff, and you do the most of your social contacts is on the internet. But still, how many in this room, I can imagine a few of you can, but how many in this room can explain exactly what happens between that we send a text message and then when it, you know, and it arrives in someone else's phone? Do you know what happens when you send a mail? Technically, can you explain that to me? Very few can. And the point of that is that if we don't know how stuff work, we construct it ourselves. We build a story that we can understand and that we can sort of relate to. And I think that this is sort of a story that shows us the view that a lot of kids have of the internet. It's that Talking Angela is a hacking pedophile who can see you through your phone. Who can see, you know, you don't only have a camera here, he has a camera there, and you can see, it's a portal. And the funny thing is that a very Swedish, a well-known Swedish folklorist called Bengt af Klintberg has said that there are two portals in every home, folklorist portals, so you know, kind of portals in our minds to the other world, to another world with other threats that we don't know about. The first portal is the mirror, of course, very widely used in ghost stories and stuff like that. Mirrors are sort of doors to other worlds. The second one is the TV. Which everybody who's seen the movie Poltergeist can understand, the TV or the ring, the TV as sort of a portal to another place. And I suggest that the third one is the internet, as a portal to a place that threatens us. Because we are folkloristically, well, in a folklorist sense, we are treating the internet as a portal to a scary place. My last point will be this: why do we tell these stories? Why do we believe these stories? This is a thing that was circulating on Facebook a couple of years ago. Alva, 9 years old, had an iPhone cover with a Swedish flag on it in school, and she got detention. That was the story. And this story appeals to a lot of people who feel that the Swedish flag today is branded as racist. There's a lot of, you know, debate about that, like, you can't even use the Swedish flag, and you can't even celebrate Christmas, because if you do, you're a racist. You can't even do this, that, or that, because if you do, you're branded as racist. I would suggest none of that is true, and if you just fucking Google Sweden, you'll see how many Swedish flags come up. There's nothing racist about it. But a lot of people feel that, you know, they will be branded as racist if they use the Swedish flag. So that's why this story works. It circulates because, you know, that's the worldview of a lot of these people. And what happened was that this came up in a Facebook group. A lot of people said, no, this is fake. It comes from this and that site, which is fake, and blah, 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 this is fake. And then this guy showed up. He said, jag skiter I att det är fake, det är för jävligt ändå. Which translates to, I don't care that it's fake, it's still fucked up. Which is funny. I grant you that. It is funny. But I'm sorry to pull the rug under you now, but it's also serious, deeply serious. Because what he is saying right there is that in my worldview, in the world that I see, in the world that I live in, this is racist. And I cannot use the Swedish flag, because if I do, I will be branded a racist. He's saying that he so deeply believes that, that it's no matter that this, you know, one example seems to be fake, because the worldview still stands. This is true, according to him. And as long as I am standing over here, in my part of the playing ball, whatever, in my part of the room, and he's standing over there in his part of the room, and we're just laughing at each other, there will be very little dialogue. And there will be very little understanding. And that's an issue. That's an issue going forward, that we don't communicate at all. If you're interested at all in what I've been talking about, I would suggest you going to the website snopes.com and just reading a whole lot. Snopes.com is a website that for 20 years have been collecting and debunking, but also writing about the things that we share on social media that are fake. This is a gold mine. And if you are working in or around a school, I implore you, use urban legends in your lecturing. Because urban legends is not only a, you know, a walkthrough in critical thinking and finding sources and doing research, it's also a detective hunt. It's very hard not to be amused by trying to check out the facts and sources to stories like these. And for the third, it's also always good stories. As I've been talking about previously, these stories need to work with our worldview. They need to be compelling. They need to be interesting. They need to be, in every way, satisfying reads. So these stories are always good. And if you can use them in schools or in lecturing and education, please do. And that's it for me.
Thank you very much, Jack. That was really great. And we will have also time to discuss later. Now I pass to the next presentation. And I'm really happy to introduce Hans Bernhard, that we know each other now for decades, I would say. So I'm really proud to have you with us again. Hans is the founder, together with Livlix, of the artistic project known as UBERMORGEN. They are working since a long time on the discourse of media hacking and also online performance. And I really like the way also you write your influences. Basically, the influences for the UBERMORGEN are Rammstein, Samantha Fox, Guns N' Roses, Duran Duran, Hoffman's LSD, Lindt Dark Chocolates, and KFC Coconut Shrimps Deluxe. Wow. So after knowing this kind of influence you have, I'm really looking forward to your presentation. And I would say that Hans and Livslix are really the master and wizards of facts, truths, fake, and consensual hallucinations. So I really look forward to what you're going to tell us today.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks. Yeah, wonderful. Thanks so much. I was. It's nice to be. I'm not going to be that funny. It's impossible. But I try to attach the thing I want to say to what you said. So I'm going to talk about consensual hallucination. A long time ago, we have realized that reality surpasses fiction and dystopian science fiction with lightning speed. With one of our projects from 2011, Asylabwehramt, Asylum Defense Agency. Oh, where are we? Oh, yeah. Okay, I wanted to do that. I thought it's gonna jump. Let me do that quickly. there we go. No. Okay.
Gather windows.
I just do it like that. Can I? I'm losing. Oh, yes, my back. Great, okay. A bit closer, isn't it very loud, like that? Okay, you tell me, it's gonna be really loud, but you can steer it, huh? Okay, this is Asylum Defense Agency, Asylabwehramt, which is a bureaucratic and aesthetic merger between the Bundesamt für Migration und Flüchtlinge, like a ministry for asylum or migration, and the Abwehramt, a military intelligence service. We try to use over-affirmative dystopian fiction as a method to create stories that go beyond the factual, or if you want, below or beside. That was when we developed the project. We failed, since after doing that and looking at the current consensus and the factual world, our minds were raped over and over by what we saw and what we felt. So actually, reality has surpassed our most dystopian ideas of what we thought we could conceptualize to create this installation. The developments at the time and the strategies used by politics, security agencies, and our society as a global organism clashed with our expectation of the perceived negotiated consensual hallucination. This has created a vacuum of real feelings and brought the fringe to the center and the bottom to the top. We have then rebuilt this emotion into an administrative process and environment that you can partially see but not feel on the images behind me. Let's see if it works. We created a bureaucratic machine without humans, fiction without an author, truth without anybody to tell and talk about it. The post-factual world is not a new phenomenon, not at all. But I love that the world has finally come to an agreement, and I love the idea that there are so many others consensually hallucinating with us in understanding the fact that we are, in fact, part of a post-factual world. After the dissolution of the artificially created schism between the so-called virtual space and the universe, some might call it the material world or the physical, we became blinded. But we try to overcome this painful unification process by going beyond our current and or historical classification of truth. Historically, such concepts were constructed and upheld by strong institutions, such as the church or universities by ways of science. But since these institutions lost grip on our world, it became impossible to pinpoint evil, and as a consequence, the truth. Hence, we have affirmatively moved beyond such definitions. We were scared because there was nobody telling us what to think and feel. But instead of using the available methodologies and advancements in thinking and technology, we as a people have decided to close our eyes and celebrate in a neo-Biedermeier fashion. This led to the truth, or plural, the truths, to become questions of faith again, very similar to how we imagine the Dark Ages. This might be a natural, maybe even necessary backlash, but it also explains that why we celebrate whistleblowers as the new messiahs, or condemn them and persecute them as the new male witches of the post-digital age. So how can we overcome this form of binary primitivism? Today we have to think beyond the idea of the validity of sources. We have to be responsible on our own, for our own thinking and our own conclusions, without weighing on singular sources, but on an overcharged, unstructured, and seemingly unknown universe of information, driven by different agendas, coming from different origins, telling us contradictory, fantastic, realistic, ugly, or beautiful stories. In the hotel room, it's much easier to do in front of the mirror. It's not that exhausting. And your mouth doesn't dry out. Funnily enough, eh? It's the same text, it's the same length. What the fuck? Was that funny? That too? Jesus, let's go on. Let's do it. Okay. This is very liberating, since we are allowed to skip scientific procedures and make up our own stories. Create our own universe by making up our own mind. Create our own truths, without feeling guilty or having to justify ourselves. This is indeed post-factual in the best sense. And I really love the word, I really do. Finally, in a renaissance of disinformation and propaganda by uncountable amounts of actors and unaccountable actors, this is our very best shot. It requires self-confidence and calm. It demands discipline and openness, but mostly requires acceptance. Acceptance when it comes to excessive demands, overload, and insecurity. We need to calm the fuck down. Yes, we do need data abstraction to understand information on a visual and emotional level, and not on an individual factual level. This liberates our thinking and helps us to create resolutions. The more uncertain an event, the more information is required to resolve uncertainty. I was training this word, but I got it wrong again. Again, the more uncertain an event, the more information is required to resolve uncertainty of that event. Nobody is immune to manipulation, but stop calling it disinformation, fake news, manipulated sources. This terminology is based on an anachronistic belief that there is real news and sources without agenda. This is naive, we all know better. There is dire need for upping the ante and becoming less responsible or much more irresponsible users. So I cannot stop pointing this out. We use affirmation as the ultimate technique for thinking and feeling. We use anything we see for anything we can think of, and we refrain from trying to understand, from trying to construct truth and reality. What we do is creating a state of insecurity, filling a void in between, looking for the middle ground between on and off, between zero and one. One word about our research technique. For us, all sources are equal. It's like one source, one vote, so to say. This approach allows us to cope with our own realness and helps us to dive into vast areas of information where we have no, and as a consequence, want no control over the validity of sources and facts. We just use any facts, any source, the way we think it makes sense and serves our purpose. Like the guy who says, fuck it, it's my, or Newt Gingrich says, I believe it's not true. So the purpose of the project we work on, yeah? I used to always paint this picture of Übermorgen using information from any source as if it were tiny rocks. And I really like the image. That's why I really like the truth teller's image. Tiny rocks, and we'd collect a large amount of these rocks and then create a huge mosaic. Our own truth, our own beliefs, our own ideas and associations would serve as sources exactly as well as any other incredible or classically credible source. This is the beauty of it. It is fiction, but truth. In German we say Wirklichkeit oder Unwirklichkeit. Here I would like to quote Inke Arns in a text she wrote about Übermorgen's for originals. Übermorgen.com, as a start quote now, Übermorgen.com has coined the term for originals. For originals designate an original document or legal papers that in the narrow sense of the word are not originals anymore, i.e. such documents which have been created by the machine, in German, maschinell erstellt, and which have and which are valid without signature. For original is a neologism for from to forge and original. In the end, according to Übermorgen.com, such for original documents are nothing more than pixels on a screen and ink on paper. For originals claim authenticity, but at a closer inspection, turn out to be nothing more than a consensual hallucination, brackets William Gibson, end quote. This concept of the foriginal needs to be put in a temporal context. It was written in 2006 based on a legal development from Vote Auction, the injunction generator, which was a reaction to hundreds of legal documents sent to us, where we then created a machine to automatically create legal documents to be sent back. And a few years later, the bank statement generator to create our own financial truth and not to be mood dependent from a statement from your financial institution. And now to something completely different, but the same. We jump in time from 2001 to 2013. Let's see how it works. Yeah, good jump. So. We met Edward Snowden at Vienna's International Airport in Vienna on July 2, 2013, shortly after Bolivia's presidential aeroplane, having been denied the right to cross their respective airspace by France, Spain, Italy, and Portugal, was forced to land in Schwechat. Snowden has been on board as a guest of Evo Morales shortly after the arrival of the plane. A close friend of ours who works at the airport tipped us off. It took us less than 30 minutes to grab our stuff and arrive by cab. A friend guided us through airport security into a rather filthy office area in the former main terminal. We found Edward Snowden in a small, stuffy, neon-lit room where he seemed to have been deposited like a questionable parcel that nobody wanted to touch or knew what to do with. After our initial hello and how are yous, Edward described the rather strained behavior of the Austrian authorities. He said they seemed to go out of their way in order to not have to talk to him. They wanted to keep their record clean and stay neutral. They're good at that. Historically, having served as an intelligence hub between East and West, Austria has a record of facilitating secret service meetings that few other countries can match. We were quite astonished that there were no OGAs in the room with Mr. Snowden, so we grabbed the opportunity and started to talk with him. He immediately lightened up and actually seemed happy to see a couple of friendly faces. We spoke quietly but fast, since we had no idea how long and how much talking time we had left. Here is a tiny excerpt from this conversation. The transcript of the whole conversation can be found online and in print in the exhibition catalog from Übermorgen's User Unfriendly show at Carol Fletcher in London in 2013. Übermorgen, Edward, welcome to the internet. It's great for us to meet you, even if the circumstances are rather weird. Actually, only 45 minutes ago, we were discussing your Hong Kong video interview with Greenwald and Poitras as we were preparing food for our two little girls. The food is probably still hot, and we're sitting here with you, the most wanted person on Earth. We're a bit overwhelmed, I must say, but anyway, how do you feel being parked in a shitty room here, coming straight from the lap of luxury and security in the presidential plane? Has anybody talked to you since your arrival? Do you feel all this is real, or is it like a bad dream? Edward Snowden. I'm not really scared, but I don't feel okay. Nobody talked to me. You're actually the first people to direct a full sentence towards me since we touched down. I had a really interesting and revealing conversation with President Morales on the way here. He's a brilliant entertainer and a very intelligent man, and he helped me contextualize certain political aspects of the ongoing situation that has been very helpful. But I'm angry about having to land here in Vienna. I hope we will soon be in the air again and on our way to Latin America. We're suddenly made to feel uncomfortable by English-speaking people entering the room. The group included Austrian officials, uniformed Bundespolizei, Austrian Federal Police, the Bolivian ambassador, a Russian-speaking lady, and what seemed to be a team leader of the Cobra Special Police Unit. When we indicate that we would like to stay, we are bluntly threatened with arrest. We tried to take a couple of photos, but our mobile phones were immediately taken away. We received them 6 weeks later, minus the photos. Edward Snowden, I think I need to go. Goodbye. Übermorgen. Thanks, Edward. Good luck. This was the last we saw of Snowden. Austrian officials unofficially told us that he was about to be covertly sent back to Moscow's Sheremetyevo International Airport in an unidentified plane. Until today, both Austrian authorities and Bolivian diplomats have officially denied the presence of Edward Snowden in Vienna, presumably in order not to endanger their good relationships with the US. During the visit, we discussed certain issues that had to be deleted before publication. We have established a back channel with Edward Snowden since then, and we communicate from time to time. We're in receipt of an encrypted data package, some unencrypted samples, and several video messages delivered to us by different couriers. His communication methods are awesome, and we would like to publish them for people to use them, but at Edward Snowden's request, we agreed not to do so for the time being. The mentioned encrypted data package is part of the installation Do You Think That's Funny? The Snowden Files. You can see the installation here behind me. So this is the close-up. This is basically that's the whole installation. By the way, and I wrote that down, Snowden is an asshole, a condescending patriotic prick that wants to make America great again. And now to something completely different, but still in the same ballpark. Last project, 3-4 minutes, then I'm done. Tight. Okay, now we have to do another operation here. We move that over. Oh, we don't see that, so we have to do that. Kill list is a target list of people that need to be killed. The first list was manually created and edited and is still in production by UBERMORGEN. The overall concept of the kill list is a death list, that's the content. A network protocol, that's the software, and a electronic installation, that's the hardware, that's a close-up you see in the back. The death list targets are algorithmically determined based on data related to the distribution and possession of capital. Currently, there are 362 names on the kill list. The list is a fluid technical object consisting of data particles traveling anonymously and encrypted through our networks by using the kill list protocol. Within the materialized technical installation, four black beagle bones are connected via a serial port, sending liquid data, or whatever you want to call that, and guaranteeing that the file, the kill list, is in constant flow. So there is no memorizing it, there is no writing it somewhere. It's basically like a ping pong ball that is being played back and forth. That's also the idea behind this protocol. Any hold up, downtime, or intervention leads to the loss of the encrypted file and the system collapses and self-destructs. It is the truth that we have created this list and as a consequence, the kill list protocol, and that there are 362 names on it. It is true that putting the first name onto the list creates a whole universe of ethical, legal, and security dilemmas that one can easily be trapped in forever. It is not true that we have been incarcerated for this list, but it is true that with the only means to an end we came up with while looking at the state of asymmetric distribution of wealth. It is true that it's better to do something than to do nothing. It is not true that it is better to do something than do nothing. It is true that we were influenced by the Red Army Fraction, RAF, and especially by Ulrike Meinhof's early writings. It is true that there is almost nothing to be found about the kill list online. It is not true that we have taken it down. It is true that I'm scared. And it is true that aesthetics and mannerisms will kill us during this neo-Biedermeier era we're living in. And finally, it is true that we have stayed 3 days at the Trump Hotel in Las Vegas this summer. And it was fucking fantastic. And I love Las Vegas. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hans. Really, it was a great presentation, and also you actually give a performance with your passion, so thanks a lot for that. And then we will have time to discuss later. But now I want to introduce the last speakers, and I already had the pleasure to introduce them, especially Carmen, some months ago when we did our event Bots in London. And now I wanted to invite them back also because I think that it's important to show what you are doing here in Berlin. So I'm happy to introduce Carmen Weisskopf and Domagoj, Smoljo. Did I say it correct? It's a complicated name. From the Mediengruppe Bitnik. And they are also working, I would say, with the hidden sides of the internet and also the discourse of loss of control to challenge the established structure and mechanism of our online and real culture. I don't want to anticipate too much what you're going to speak about, but I also suppose that there will be something also about an encounter with somebody, especially of your parcel that got to know Julian Assange, so I leave that to you, and I'm really happy to have you here, and then we will discuss later.
Thank you for the introduction. Hi, thanks for having us here, thanks for inviting us again. So yes, we're Mediengruppe Bitnik. We work in and on the internet, with the internet, and from the beginning, the internet had a special appeal for us as artists because it was very easy to publish, very easy to become part of a network, which as a young artist is not necessarily the case, speaking about the art world. So we actually started experimenting online, I think before we even properly formed our like an artistic identity, I guess. For us, the internet has given us an incredible freedom to create, to work with people, to do stuff online, and we've always been drawn to subculture, to folklore also, and our special focus or interest has always been with the intersection between the internet and whatever we call the physical space, which actually now has come a lot closer together than when we started out. When we started out, this was still regarded as two more or less separate spaces. So we've always been interested in that intersection. And I think as a first example, we'd like to show one of our oldest works. It's called Opera Calling. And I think we'd like to show this because we did something here which is very typical for our work. We like to research into media uses, we like to look at how technology is used immediately after it's been invented, because usually that use is very different to what later becomes the normal or the standard use of a technology. And for us, talking about truths or factual approach to this, these first uses always open up alternative views or alternative uses or spaces in which you can sort of ask yourself, what can we also do with the telephone? And that's what we asked here. So we became really interested in the Zurich Opera House. We come from Zurich. We were based in Zurich. And the Zurich Opera House is special in that it's a place where especially youth culture sort of crystallized in asking for their own cultural spaces to produce money, to express themselves. And these demonstrations happened before the Zurich Opera House, because the Zurich Opera House at that time in the 80s received 90, close to 100%.
95% of all the cultural money went to this place. 5% to theater, art, dance, ballet, whatever else. So these numbers have changed over the last 20 years. Now it's only 80% which go to that house. But we've fought, it's still kind of a good playground. I mean, like, there is like this produced kind of realities that people still think there's something wrong about this house. It's still there. It's kind of elitarian. And we kind of felt that it feels like the opposite of the internet. It's not open. You cannot go there dressed however you want. It's expensive. It's kind of, you know, it didn't fit with all the kind of open culture things which were around in 2006, 2007. And at the same time, we're interested in kind of try to engage with the term of hacking and try to use hacking, you know, somehow artistically. I mean, like, is there a way to do that? And this was kind of the first project we worked with that method.
Yeah. And so basically we found this... in our research, we found this very beautiful image of a use of the telephone in the 19th century, so around 18-something after the telephone was invented. Basically, the telephone was... there were companies trying to sell it commercially right after the telephone was invented, and the problem they had was they couldn't, get a phone and then wait for somebody else to get a phone in your town and then you can call those people. So what they did was they networked any cultural institutions in a town to the telephone network, and you subscribe to that to that cultural institution. They also ran news or, there were telephone orchestras. This happened in Europe, but also in the US. Basically, here you see the family at home is listening to the opera singer here. In the middle, that sort of depicts the telephone network, that abstract thing in between. And the family at home is listening to the telephone more in the sense of a radio. This fascinated us a lot. This use disappeared when the radio was invented. And we thought, well, what, can we, you know, can you do this again 100 years later? Can you distribute the Zurich Opera to the local telephone network, because they're the people paying for it, so maybe they'd like to subscribe?
Yeah, and the only thing is we didn't want to ask for permission. So instead of like using official microphones, we would place bugs inside the opera, hijack their audio feed, retransmit it to the exhibition space, which would be here, and from there just like call anybody from the telephone book and retransmit the opera. So this was kind of the conceptual background, and yeah, so this is...
This is
an image of the Zurich Opera, how it looks like. So it's super gold and everything. And this is an image of the
director
of the opera house, yeah. In a screenshot of a TV news outlet, where he's holding one of those bugs in his hands, and he was kind of surprised in the television that he was dealing with a normal phone, because they thought, you know, they were dealing with kind of some kind of James Bond-like devices. And yeah, this was one of the first phones they've kind of found, and we always told them that we won't stop till they found every of one of those bugs. And then the question appeared, I mean, like, how many bugs are there? And to one journalist we would say 2, to the other one we would say 5, to the next one we would say 10. And
Do you want to quickly show the film? In the end, the opera refrained from suing us. They sent us quite a harsh letter, which basically said that if we wouldn't come and get out all the bugs out of the opera, they would have the Swiss military come in and we would have to pay for it. Essentially, I guess because also the media pressure, and because this raised discussions around open culture, around who has access to culture, which is publicly funded, those types of questions, and it, of course, it installed in a sense a story of open access into reality, which sort of also gave the journalists an excuse to talk about these topics. The opera, in the end, refrained from suing
us.
Like,
copyright was one of the points. For clear, I mean, like, it's all in our project. Copyright has always been like a censoring tool. Yeah. Bam, you do something. Bam, you got copyright infringement. Something, and the second one was a libel.
Yes.
Was about libel, where the opera singers were kind of unhappy with the quality of the sound. And they said, I mean, like, you know, you could think that they are singing bad or whatever, and we should just, like, stop it.
Well, the singers actually said it was only one guy, the percussionist, who
came from the artist union. They pushed that. But also them, in the end, they kind of disappeared. So we'll just like show you one of the files, like one of those telephone calls. So it's Sunday afternoon, 2007, and the family receives the opera telephone. And so we called them. So they didn't call us. So it was like a service they didn't want or something.
Ja, hallo, grüezi. Hier ist das autonome Operntelefon der Stadt Zürich. Zu Ihrer Freude und Unterhaltung haben wir in der Zürcher Oper eine Wanze platziert. In wenigen Sekunden werden Sie live ins Opernhaus verbunden. Sie können bequem von Ihrem Wohnzimmer aus der heutigen Vorstellung von der Rosenkavalier von Richard Strauss beiwohnen. Viel Spaß!
Du kannst ja. Das Opernhaus live verstehen.
Ja. Hallo, was soll das? Das ist großartig. Du, ich häng da auf, hä? Ich häng da auf, was soll das Ganze? Ich will ja keine Oper. Wie? Nee, noch nicht. Ja, hier, da singt einer, wunderschön. Ja. Also hier, dann komm mal. Also die Akustik ist eine absolute Katastrophe. Aber bitte, was bringt hier? Da hast du das.
Michael, ich muss euch die Aktion erklären. Sie rufen Leute an, wählen sie aus, so der Zufallsgenerator. Das Opernhaus, das wird so stark subventioniert und nur die reichen Leute haben was davon. Und jetzt haben sie Wanzen angebracht und jetzt kann man die Oper jetzt live, das spielt sich jetzt ab, kann man die Oper miterleben.
Gibt es eine Telefonnummer?
Nee, das nicht.
So they have like their own truth of who is like responsible for the thing. So, I mean, like, this project was kind of a good success, and the opera started to reevaluate their kind of relationship to the public. So they went out to the they did like big performances in the train station of Zurich, everything for free, live on TV with Arte and ARD and live Swiss television and things. But although this project was kind of, you know, had a lot of visibility, we kind of didn't feel good about it. So there was like this specific point which we all laughed about, like in the video, is that we building the project, we didn't realize that we are not only bugging the opera, we're also bugging the people at home. And this, we didn't want to do that, but somehow due to technical kind of limitations with our server we used like for telephony and things, we couldn't split like the two lines, and there was like this kind of security privacy breach. I mean, like, we could listen to the family sitting there, and didn't feel good. So we started to kind of watch out and see what kind of surveillance systems are around.
So the following year, we had the European Championships in Switzerland and Austria. This, of course, as has been told many times, was used by the state to install and test new security systems within our cities because of all the hooligans who would come and, you know, destroy and, you know,
rape our children.
Exactly.
Or whatever.
And we started experimenting with video cameras, and from our perspective, we didn't only want to, you know, critically think about these systems, which are closed systems and are only accessible to the people who run them, basically, but we as artists also wanted to know what images they produce, because these are essentially cameras that run 24/7, and they're recording all this life within our cities, this documentation of every day of, you know, usually nothing ever happens. So a bit the opposite of the videos we saw in the intermediate. We were really interested in, you know, what do these cameras see? What do people find interesting enough to point a camera at the thing? And we quickly found out that there are two surveillance, or at the time there were two surveillance systems used, and one of them, which ran on 2.4 gigahertz wireless, basically was usually unencrypted and easily accessible. If you got the receiving end of the system, we thought, well, if we walk around with the receiving end and a battery pack, we should be receiving images all the time when we walk around our city. And this was a lot of fun to do because we did receive a lot of city images in cities. We've done these walks. So for a time, we started to do walks, invite people on walks with us through their cities to look at the surveillance within their cities. And it's, even if you're very critical of surveillance, it's something very fascinating to do because you get to see images like this. And you basically stand outside a building and you're receiving this image or this image, and you start making up a story, you know, what could this be? And you start realizing, okay, all these cameras usually point from above down. They look at something like a door or a whatever, a gate. We also, you know, did walks with art students who did performances for the cameras. It's this performance for this one person watching, hopefully. And as an intervention, we did surveillance chess in 2012, right before the Olympic Games in London. And this basically turned around what we had done. We got the transmitting side of the system and basically tried to override any images we found and send our own images to people surveilling public space. We'll show you the video.
I've hijacked your surveillance camera. I'm the one with the yellow suitcase. How about a game of chess? You are white. I am black. Black. Call me, or text me to make your move. This is my phone number, 0758246-0851.
Recordings are always from the perspective of the video or the surveillance camera. And yeah, we did the performance a few times. We would leave after around 5 minutes. Nobody ever called. Nobody wanted to play chess. Everyone complained. They were always happy when we said it's art. They were like, okay, so you'll leave soon. That sort of. But it was sort of attempt also to engage these systems in a sort of an artistic approach.
So, like, this was 2012, and during that time we would be hanging out in London a lot, and this was just like the time, you know, Anonymous was kind of big, Julian Assange was just like approaching the Ecuadorian embassy, 2012 summer?
Yes.
Yeah. So we became really interested in the situation Julian Assange is living. It's just like as a physical manifestation of something which is happening right now. So so he was at the Ecuadorian embassy at that time. You would come from the tube station, Knightsbridge, past Harrods, it's like a shopping area, and then you would stand in front of this heavy militarized zone. And it felt like a war. It felt kind of a war zone in a Western country, but and normally, like, the images are lacking for it. So we know that something is happening, but, you know, nobody, yeah, there is no physical evidence of that. We're kind of interested in the architecture, in the space which was involving there.
Yeah, so basically we felt that looking at the outside of the Ecuadorian embassy, you sort of got a feel for what was going on around these disputes. You know, should information be free? Should people be able to, or, you know, should people hack online? Should kids be allowed to download stuff? Those sort of conflicts that you usually never got an image for, or there was never this sort of a place to go to. They were all like separate events in the news over time, but not feelable as a conflict. We sort of felt that being locked up at the Ecuadorian embassy in London was sort of an image, or gave that an image or an example of somebody who had done work within that conflict. And we decided that we wanted to... Now, I think our first question was a bit, how can we involve ourselves as artists? How can we sort of, you know, in this, it's this geopolitical stalemate, and everyone goes like, oh my God, you know, you can't, what are you going to do? And we sort of felt that there must be a way we could sort of try to physically involve ourselves within that situation, and we... looked at the systems that were around the Ecuadorian embassy. We quickly realized that the postal system was still fully functional. There were people going in and out every day, you know, delivering stuff. And we thought, oh wow, that, you know, it's the police people, the postal people cross this police barrier, this, you know, this war zone, this locking off. We thought, oh, that's nice. Why, you know, what would happen if we sent Julian Assange an email? Everyone would read it, you know, everyone would read it. Probably.
Like every country, the email would pass.
On the way to, from our email, or from our email server to wherever it would land. And but there's this funny thing called postal secrecy. You can't just read a letter you write somebody, not even in that situation. It's not allowed, still not allowed. And we don't have that online, isn't that strange? And so we basically wanted to write a letter, but then needed a means of getting feedback from that letter. We wanted to know what would happen to this letter. Would, you know...
Would they open it? Which route would it take? Would, like, Julian Assange receive it? Or would it be opened by MI5? Things like that.
So basically we built a parcel with a hole in the side, which you can see there. And behind that hole, we placed the camera, and the camera just took a picture of the surroundings of the parcel every 10 to 15 seconds and uploaded that image live to the internet, to our server. So there was, on our website, you could watch this parcel, you know, you could see what this parcel was doing.
So we went to London in January 2013. We lived at Adnan's place, which is in East London, addressed it to Julian Assange, which is in West London. And yeah, we'd start the experiment. And we had no idea if it was interesting or not, but we, you know, it felt already kind of intriguing. This was one of the first pics we published, which is the X-ray of the puzzle. You would see the mobile phone here, the battery pack, and some electronics which we used. And there's no letter, there's nothing. So kind of the medium is the message. And this is one of the first pics the parcel would take. This is like a postal office, or like a kiosk. And you see me here, you see me standing here. It's like an artist portrait, really small, and the parcel. And
we weren't at all sure whether the parcel would be accepted. I mean, it was addressed to Julian Assange and it also had a hole in it, but they luckily didn't realize that there was a hole and they weren't really interested in the address. So the parcel was accepted and it immediately disappeared in this red bag.
Yeah, and it would stay in a red bag for hours. Just like we and the internet started to watch this strange picture of red bag, and you know, from time to time something will happen, but most of the time it was black. It was just like, it was too dark. It was somewhere, it was too dark, it would just be black.
Because it was a phone, we also had a type of location data, which wasn't always very accurate, but we could sort of follow the parcel when it was dark. We could still sort of, you know, follow whether it was moving or not. This was later in the, so we posted the parcel around midday, and then later in the evening, towards the evening, this was one of the first images we got after a long period of blackness. And it had sort of reappeared in a postal office in East London.
So we should just go through really fast. We only have 3 minutes left. So what we liked about it is like the, also here, it's like the loss of control, that we cannot narrate the story. We don't know what's happening to it. So we can just like follow it from behind, and you know, we didn't have too much information, but there was pictorial evidence of something happening, something which was carried through the postal system. And
yeah. And I mean, it aroused a lot of interest online. People were very helpful. So at times our server nearly collapsed under so many people trying to watch these images, and people put up mirrors. People helped us identify what the parcel was doing, where it was heading. Postal workers wrote to us to explain what was happening to the parcel.
What the green bag means, or the
green and the red bag, and you know, and people were really, really genuinely excited by this work. And I think we, you know, as artists, you have this idea of something might be interesting. Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. Sometimes it's only interesting to a few people. And this we realized, especially after it arrived, which is right about now. So now we're already at the embassy, or the parcel is already at the embassy. I mean, this was really how we sort of talked about this, you know, this sort of, it felt like this living thing that was, you know, people would ask each other online, where are we, what's happening to us? And then you see Julian Assange comes on, and it's, I think it also moved people because it was, although it's mediatized, of course, but it's not mediatized by the usual news outlets. It's this sort of, I think to people it felt like a private channel they had.
Maybe the last thing you
want
to speak
about. Just quickly, we then also showed this in a larger exhibition we had in Zurich as a two-channel video installation with all the around 10,000 images the parcel produced over the course of
40 hours? For
36, I think, hours. And afterwards, we also visited Julian, so we saw the inside of this place that fascinated us so much, this Ecuadorian embassy, and we recreated for the exhibition the space where he's living at the Ecuadorian embassy.
So this is our parcel here, which arrived. This is a bag from Vivian Westwood.
And we created this from memory because you're not allowed to take pictures of the inside of the Ecuadorian embassy. And I think what fascinated us about the space is also this clash of embassy sort of furniture, which is sort of semi-usable, and hacker culture that sort of then spreads on top. And this being able to participate in geopolitical questions, although you're confined to a very small space in London, at an embassy.
So our goal is to like to bring that room to London, to have like the real room and the simulation of it in the same town. We think this would be like a nice clash. What we have done so far, now it was just, it's in Nantes at the moment, traveling to Paris and then going to Liverpool for an exhibition, and invited another artist, Adam Harvey, who kind of virtually hijacks people, the geolocation of their mobile phones. And if you enter the room now, also your mobile phone starts to believe that you are at the Ecuadorian embassy. So if you pop up Google, this is doing by like interfering with like the Wi-Fi networks which are around, which Google uses and Apple uses. So you would have like the feeling of being there. So in Nantes, in this exhibition, it's like an own reality which is produced here. In Nantes, this exhibition's kids started to come to play Pokemon in London, and which, you know, gave them some tools. Also, people came in to use Tinder there, so it's kind of it's an okay. So we'll stop here because Thanks. We're running out of time. Sorry.
So since I saw that we are running a bit late, but okay, we also started late, so I think that is fine, but I don't want to take too much space now. And I think that with this presentation, we also saw a really interesting aspect of the discourse, so from one side of art, but also evidence. And I think, I also want to reconnect with what you were saying, Hans, because we should reflect on the discourse of art as a form of truth-telling, also trying to go beyond this dichotomy, either telling the truth or telling the fake. But at the same time, I also think that we should play with this concept and trying to understand by also stretching the limit, what are the possibility inside the discourse of truth-telling. Maybe then in the conversation I would like to understand a bit more what you meant about this dichotomy. But I think also what you just discussed also shows that the truth is a construction, and also we have to work creatively to unfold it and try to use it also to denounce form of powers and give new form of meaning. But now really I want to open to the public, so please, if you have any questions, we are happy to hear. No questions so far? So maybe I would just ask you if you could explain a bit better what you meant about this dichotomy. And also, I have also really small question for you, but just I will ask you to be short, so the people in between think about something. I wanted to ask you a bit better to define what are the creepypasta, because I think it's an interesting concept that not all the people know. And also another for you is that when we were discussing together, you were also mentioning the fact that you try to send a parcel to Chelsea Manning. And I think this is another interesting aspect, because you didn't succeed on that. So maybe you can tell us more.
So So I can't really answer. The text is the best I could get out of my fucked up brain at the moment. So it's really, I thinking about stuff like that, what I said and what we're discussing now, for me it requires a lot of thought. And it works like that I write. Or I love speaking, so talking. So usually I talk with people and I generate, I think while I talk. I can't think otherwise. Complete vacuum. It's just dead. So for me, I have to talk. I could now talk, but I would have to talk a long time to give you an answer that would make, that would be, that would have a certain quality to it. Uh-huh. Yeah. But you can send me questions by email and then I have, it's not a joke. Then I have time to reflect and I can write and then maybe something halfway intelligent.
Yeah, okay. So I will send you an email. Good.
I don't mean this in a condescending way.
I'm serious about it.
I really always hate the question thing because it gives me the creeps. I don't know what to do and then I get aggressive or not or defensive. And it's not a good
okay,
thing.
Okay, good. Me. I think it's already an answer. Okay.
In a way. Yeah. But so when you formulate the answer, do you talk for yourself? Do you sit in front of your computer and talk by yourself? And
that's why I always used a sidekick, but then these sidekicks get crazy ideas. They think they develop the ideas and you know shit like that. So you run into trouble with these people,
and then you get aggressive and
yeah.
It just
I recognize they can actually do the same thing by writing. It works the same. It just has to flow out and it has to go somewhere.
All right, so a parenthesis about something entirely different, which is not uninteresting at all. This is sort of actually what I've liked about this particular panel and the setup of it is that I have been thinking during your presentations that I've gotten the sad feeling that we are somehow enemies. Because you deconstruct truth while I try to construct truth. And I'm trying really hard to not, to actually try to construct somehow some kind of a world that my readers can recognize themselves in. And, you know, as a journalist, you're always trying your best to be sort of a safe haven in the information environment. And the problem with the internet is that information is very easy to decontextualize, and as soon as information is decontextualized, it's almost worthless in an informational sense, in the sense that, you know, I want to sort of, you know, make decisions based on this information. So in that way, your story about Edward Snowden could very well pass as either a true or a lie, and you would probably not know about it. And this actually offers me a segue into an answer to your question about creepypasta, which is that, so creepypasta, just to sort of to describe the concept, is basically creepy stories or images that are shared on the internet. That's it. The word comes from copy-paste, which on 4chan in 2007 started to be discussed as copypasta, sort of a substantive. And then when that text or image, which is copied and pasted online, is creepy, meant to disturb, meant to told as a ghost story, it is creepypasta. So creepypasta are ghost stories that are circulated on social media. And sometimes they are very old stories. I mean, there's, for example, a story written in 1921 about a news agency's headquarter that starts to get a lot of strange reports from an unknown country in an unknown city. The story speaks about horrific fogs coming up and screams out of the fog, and it's all, you know, taken shape in this sort of these sorts of short reports over the line. And that story, even though it's 100 years old, have been actually passed around online as a, you know, contemporary creepy story. But it's also very contemporary in another sense. It has a lot to do with our how hard it is to adapt to the fact that we are always, in a sense, very connected, and we are always, in a sense, very close to everything. Because the interesting thing about an anonymously written ghost story is that it kind of shortcuts your demands to know what the source is. Because if it's a ghost story and it's written anonymously and you cannot for your life get the hold of the writer, then it could be anybody. The writer of the story could be anybody. And if it's a realistic story, for example, I was in my whatever living room the other day and something happened and, you know, this and that, and that, you know, you sort of make a reliable, a credible, scary story out of it, and then you post it without any geographical facts, without any facts about who you are as a storyteller. For, I mean, you know, you do the Tintin thing in which the storyteller in itself is a very bleak character so that you can identify, you know, in the greatest sense with the storyteller. Then the storyteller could be anybody. And that's an interesting thing because it don't correlate much with my with what I do with my, the other part of my the time I'm working, which is, you know, always talking about you need to be sure about your sources, you need to check up on your sources. And when it comes to ghost stories, I'm just like, nah, because sources have very little to do with ghost stories. It's quite the opposite. So creepypasta is it's in a very real sense, it's contemporary ghost stories that are passed around on the internet. And they are often they can be very badly written because a lot of these writers are very young and their understanding of what is creepy is mostly gore. So most of the stories are like, I saw something creepy in the corner and now my intestines are on the floor. You know, you just do that jump. But sometimes they are actually really, really good. And since I started up a podcast on the Swedish Public Service Radio, which I mentioned about these kind of creepy stories, I get a whole lot of listener mail, about 50, 60 mails a week with people's own experiences, which are, you know, sometimes very gory and sometimes brilliant. So I have this, you know, sort of, I have this, much the same way you had this little window from your little box, I have an actual little window into the minds of people listening to my podcast, at least in the sense that they are telling me about what they think is scary today. And that is very valuable to me. So I hope that was...
Thanks.
You wanted us to quickly tell the story of the second box. So when we sent the parcel to Julian Assange, we wrote him so once we had gone to the post office, we wrote him a public mail, a mail we just stuck online and tried to make him aware of, which sort of explained why we were doing this. And we also told him that we saw it in a way as a sort of a chain letter, that once he received the box, he could send it on to somebody else in a similar situation he thought was interesting. And he quickly decided on Chelsea Manning, and it was very clear that the only window to send her a parcel like ours would be into the courtroom. That would be the only moment that we would have any, you know, that it would make any sense to send something containing a camera being a parcel. And we actually prepared to do this in the summer of 2013. We had actually built the box. It had contained a lot more batteries because it was going from London to the US. We knew that would take a lot more time. We needed more battery time. We had experimented a lot on, you know, how to make this a lot more fail-safe. And we went to London we didn't actually go to London. The day we had chosen to send this parcel was the day that Snowden traveled from Hong Kong to Moscow. So it wasn't, you know, exactly a day where we got WikiLeaks attention for our box. So that sort of canceled the project of sending her the box. And
also because the trial ended really fast. So everybody was thinking that the trial would go for 2 months, but it were only like 3 weeks. And yeah, with just like Snowden and Snowden being in Vienna at this time and Moscow and the whole stress, yeah, WikiLeaks being involved, we just couldn't do it then.
Yeah, and we sent the box in October of 2013 to Nabila Rajab, who is a Bahrainian human rights activist. We sent that box twice, and twice it was gone in Dubai. We don't know whether it was destroyed or dismantled. We just received no images, and the box went offline.
It was two times the airport. This still, it felt like a firewall. You know, this is just like freedom of speech or whatever, art or whatever, but hey. This is stop here, and this is
great. I just wanted to point out something because I think also Hans, my question was was a bit too complicated, but basically just to summarize it, I was asking you if you basically think that art can be a form of evidence, or would be better just to consider as a form of undermining evidence. But maybe I can write you a second email. And I just wanted to specify what I wanted, because, you know, we call this year framework art and evidence, and it's also what we're speaking today about, the discourse of truth-telling, the connection with art. So since you also did the project about Snowden, that was my question. But maybe we can speak also later about that. And now I open to the public. Yeah, Biella.
So first, thanks for all those presentations. They were really amazing. So first, just a question that anyone can answer, and then one specifically for Jack. So one of the essays I actually use in my teaching all the time is On Truth and Lies in a Non-Moral Sense by Nietzsche, where he basically rants against this idea that science gets to monopolize truth, because then everything else becomes a kind of second-class citizen. So I was just wondering if there was any texts, philosophical or fictional, that you guys draw inspiration from to, you know, work through these issues of truth and lies and evidence. So that's just a general question. And then a question for Jack. First of all, that was very refreshing that a journalist is kind of dealing with cultural, folkloric issues. So I just want to know how you got to folklore. Like, did you take anthropology classes? Are you secret anthropologists? And then the second question is, you know, you give us a kind of functionalist reading of a lot of folklore stories. Are there any times where you run into the limits of a functionalist reading where you can't find an explanation? Or are you kind of always able to be kind of like the James Bond of folklore and get to the end of it? And then likewise, you know, many of your readings have to do with fears and anxieties. Is there a kind of equivalent where it's about desires and utopian dreams and not a kind of negative side? Or is the internet particularly susceptible to the spreading of a particular type of folklore?
Should I go first, or do you want to go first again? But I'm answering my question, and I'll leave that, yeah. So first of all, why did I get into folklore? So there's, I don't know if I mentioned him, but there's a Swedish very well-known folklorist, Bengt af Klintberg. I mentioned him. It was the guy with the portals. And Bengt af Klintberg has written three books about on the topic of modern urban legends, and they are called The Rat in the Pizza, which is the most famous one. It's a very famous story about... it started circulating in Sweden in the 60s and 70s when pizza was a new thing to Sweden. And Swedes were like totally alien to the concept of pizza, even though it's just basically a big sandwich. So pizza was new to Sweden, and people started to talk about like, what is this new thing? How can we...
Is a kind of weird concept to the pizza in Sweden, especially if you think about the ananas pizza.
We also do kebab pizza, yeah. So we have kebab on the pizza, which is really good. The story goes that a woman was having pizza and she she woke up in the middle of the night after eating this pizza and with a terrible pain in her mouth. And she went to the hospital and they took out a rat's teeth out of her own tooth. And you know, the health ministry guys, whatever, went to the pizza place and discovered that they were serving rat's meat on the pizza. So that was the story, and it very clearly dealt with the fear and the anxiety about new sorts of types of food in Sweden, of course. And I read all of those books, all of these three books, during the entirety of my teenage years. And I, you know, what was very striking to me now in hindsight was that I read first the urban legends in the book, and you know, when I had read just the urban legends 10 times, I was tired of them. I could recite them exactly because I'd read them so much. So then I went over to reading the analysis that Bengt af Klintberg had written, and all of a sudden I knew a whole lot about folklore, to which you know, in fundamentally changed my way of reading the news. Because if you read the news, you read a whole lot of stories that build upon older stories. So I had read all these folklore books, and then the years went by, and in 2013 or 12, I just stumbled upon creepypasta as a phenomenon. And I read a couple of ghost stories, and I, you know, sort of marveled over them, and it took actually a very short time for me to realize that this was very much like what Bengt af Klintberg had been writing about. And in that same, you know, me being, I'm completely uneducated. I have almost not even gone through the gymnasium, the Swedish sort of high school. So I'm completely uneducated. And so I have been desperately looking for something to make myself worthwhile for my entire life. And then I figured, all right, I could read a book, I could write a book about this. And so I did. And so that's the first part. The second part does... I will. Yes, I completely realize what I'm doing here. I have been mostly focusing on the stories that deal with our fear and our anxiety, because they are often very easy to spot. And they are often the ones that get the most traction, because we take them more seriously. We build more upon them, you know. We almost sometimes also base our political belief on those kind of stories. Those kinds of stories become what we believe in a very real sense. And then, I mean, when you have positive stories, they are more, in my experience, more about certain people or events. So they are more about, for example, during the election campaigns, there was a story about this, two people were driving around in a car and the car broke down, and two people were driving around in a car and they passed by a broken down limousine on the road, and they, you know, went up to the limousine asking, can we help you somehow, and they said, yeah, please start our engine up, whatever. And when they had helped the car, the driver said, do you want to meet the rich guy in the car, so he could thank you personally? And they said, yeah, sure. And they open up the door, and it's Donald Trump, who goes, thank you, thanks a lot. What can I do to thank you? And the guys in the car say, oh, just send some flowers to our friend. She's in the hospital. And a couple of weeks later, the woman in the hospital gets flowers and a letter in which it says, I have paid off your house, signed Donald Trump. So, I mean, that's an urban legend. That's a very old urban legend that has been circulating in very many different forms and shapes. But it's very clearly about, like, how we perceive Donald Trump, or how some people have, the one half of the U.S. United States perceive Donald Trump as this larger-than-life character who, you know, does real change to the lives of real-life working people. So, I mean, the nice stories are more often about certain events in that sense. And I think I have to cut myself short then.
Well, do you want to add something?
No, I just quickly wanted to say about the texts. We read your books. Thank you very much. They help us also understand a lot of the rest. I couldn't point you to a text. Being artists, we give ourselves the freedom to, you know, take freely from wherever, whatever we read. As Hans sort of explained, we do the same. We treat all sources the same, so we would not think we were reading something more valuable just because it's written by a philosopher, or less valuable because it's in the news. But what we have sort of started also understanding, and I think this is also something maybe positive about at the internet, or this sort of this data gathering, is that it's become clear that a lot of the scientific research is based actually on very little data, and it's very biased, and it's old, and sort of, and that sort of, I think that something, or we feel something is changing there, and we think that's really interesting. But it's, it would be hard to point you to certain texts we've read, mm-hmm. but of course this relationship in the arts has always been really important between truth and fiction, and there's a ton of texts about that.
Do you want to add something, Hans?
Yeah, I emailed too, but I've really tried to get my head around for 5 minutes now. A lot of the thinking comes from my research around psychopathology of narcissism and psychopathy, which is kind of a lifelong process. So I think, take a lot from that, and always strafen und überwachen by Michel Foucault always comes to my mind. It's like a basic value. And there's good TV shows like The Wire that help me understand myself, yeah. Or how I should, yeah.
Okay, I think that we are all really running a bit late, and at the same time, today is also actually our last event. I had also prepared a little closing celebration for us, but still I want to give the possibility to give the last question from the public, and then I would like to close this year of events and ask you to be still 5 minutes with us, because there is our big moment of closing of actually almost 2 years, not 2 years program, but we will close the one of 2016. So another question? Yeah?
I have the microphone, so I just go.
Go.
I actually want to say thanks to Hans for his little intervention of truth-telling, because I think that was like a really beautiful moment where you can see that by telling the truth, or telling also some intimate truth, helps create new things, maybe a little different notion from all that whistleblower stuff that we were discussing. But actually, I have a collection about moments when artists say they cannot talk. I actually give talks about why I myself cannot give talks. I can very much identify with that. And I think, so it's perfect for me, but I also think it has a lot to do with the topic of the symposium, because when you say you were sitting at your hotel room and everything, it was the same text and everything looked very different though, I think it's really helpful to expand the notion of truth to maybe the notion of reality, because reality is also a constructed thing, just like truth, and truth is just something like words and philosophy, but reality is the whole thing around, and when you really need to include that in the notion of truth, I think. And so I also very often thought about situations where I or someone else who had heard things would be able to leak something, but then you can come up with the question, yeah, but will it help anything? Or you feel like you would have to construct a whole reality for the others to make them understand why this is important. So if people are living in a different reality, then it doesn't really fit to what their truth is and what your truth is. And so I really think in a way that neurodiversity and neurology would also make up an aspect of truth that we haven't come up with so far. So it's not just media, and it's not just collective truths narrated through state and media issues, but also collective truths based on neurological aspects maybe. And I know it opens a new chapter, but I'm really thankful to Hans, and I wanted to say that. And maybe next time.
you. Do you want to add something or we, no? Okay, so sort email to write. You will receive a lot of emails after. Okay, but so I really want to thank you for being here with us. So please an applause to our great speakers. Yeah, no. Now I will actually ask you, I mean, I will be here alone because I think you stay on stage enough. It's time to relax for everybody. I want to keep it short because, you know, I think it's late. We are all tired. But I mean, if you want, you can go and sit. You don't need to be here. I mean, if you want, of course, I'm really happy to stay with me. But I mean, I understand that after 2 hours is tiring. So I just hope to hold you a bit for 5 minutes because this is a really special moment for us because we are closing these year events with this final panel. And I don't want to do really the big closing statement because I think our brains are all overused right now, but I just want to go a bit through what we did this year, just really to make you understand that, I mean, this has been a really closing moment of a year of work that we already started in April of 2016 with the events bots. And I have to say that this year events, as I was also mentioning during the panel, were all connected with the discourse of art and evidence. That is also something that I've been already developing since years, especially also through a dialogue that I had together with Laura Poitras, Trevor Pagling, and also Jay Kappelbaum. So I'm really saying that, in a sense, these year events that we have been doing follows a path of reflection on how art and evidence could be combined and what we can do with that. So BOTS was the first one. We invited, as part of the End Festival in London, in cooperation also with the Axioma Project Space and further field, CN Westmoreland, that is another drone operator like Brandon Bryan. So that was one of the first events we did. Actually, Sian is not a drone operator, he's a drone analyst. That is another kind of job, but still the same as Brandon, is really exposing himself to tell the truth about the drone war. And so we also had the panel, as you can see, that was called Tracking the Tracker. And Carmen was there too. So we were really reflecting on the discourse of how we could interconnect a system of controls, automatism, diffuse of responsibility, and also reflecting on the discourse of surveillance. Then the second event was instead Deep Cables, is what we did in June 2016. It was actually the first event that was financed by the City Tax Program. And here we invited a lot of hacker tourists and people that were somehow disclosing and uncovering the undersea network cables and the fiber optic cables by understanding also what is the power underneath the internet infrastructure. So you see there Henry Morke, and again Trevor Pagling. Always when I turn the page, it's complicated. So we were really speaking a lot about what is the internet infrastructure and how we can disclose also surveillance related to that and power mechanism on the cable themselves. And the third event that we had, actually the one before this one, was called Ignorance, the Power of Non-Knowledge, in September, end of September, beginning of October. This was co-curated by Daniela Silvestrin, and was a bit more philosophical because we were somehow trying to reflect on ignorance as a form of positive and negative aspects of producing knowledge, but at the same time also questioning what the production of knowledge means. So we really went into the discourse of
the power of the creation of knowledge and also unfolding what knowledge is. And finally, then we are at the events of today, truth tellers. And so you understand this is part of a path that we also hope to keep doing in the next 2 years. We actually have already a program of 2 years. We just need to fund it somehow with some money. But this is another discourse. But anyway, connected to that, we are also really happy because I have to say that as Disruption Network Lab in September 2016, so really, you know, 2 months ago, we finally became a Verein. And this becoming of a Verein means that we are also a legal entity now in Berlin and in Germany, so we can also operate differently as a no-profit organization. And also I have to say the big work of Claudia Dorfmüller for that was really important because, I mean, she went into all this statute mechanism, understand, and was really a lot. But so now we are a Verein. And also I have to say that we got recently the news that part of the work of our Verein now is supported by the Open Society Foundations. So I'm really happy to say that, you know, I want to thank the Open Society Foundation for this support because it's really a structural fund, it's not bounded to events, and I think this is really important also for the things we are doing for our survival. But now we are really at the big moment, as every year, and I would like to call here on stage, and I know that they will hate me for that, but I'm really happy to do it. Kim Voss, the project manager of the Disruption Network Club, and Claudia Dorfmüller, also the project manager. So, thank you. I know that you hate me for bringing you here. Stay here, where do you go? And so you get also something for your great work. No, also, I want to say really thanks a lot to them because the Disruption Network Club is so great because they are with me. So this is really important. And also, I don't know if he's here, I hope. Is Daniela here? Ah, she's not here, he's sick, oh no. Okay, so I wanted to thank also Daniela for her work as curator for the ignorance events. So we will send her an email too, I think. And I also want to conclude by doing other greetings and thanks that we really need to do because also these people deserve to be thanked. So of course we want to thank the jury of City Tax and also the Senat Chancellery of Berlin City Tax Program for supporting us and especially Frau Julia Gutierrez-Peris, that is the manager of the Cultural Affairs Department, so that she really worked a lot with us, unfolding all these funding mechanism. And then also, especially for the event of June, the Deep Cables, the Ignorance events of September, October, the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung that supported us, especially the Department of Global Policy of Jochen Steinhilber and Katrin Kluver. And then, of course, Stefan Bauer and the Kunstankreuzberg Bethanien, and Melina Gerstemann and Selina Basra that are also always helping us at the Kunstankreuzberg to make the possibility to, you know, have this setup that we have with all the chairs. And also, of course, Stefan is a great support for me now for like almost 10 years, even more. So I'm happy to keep collaborating with him in a way. And but now we go on with our great team thanks, because I think it's important also to say that all these
fantastic visual is thanks to Jonas Franki, that is sitting over there. I think that we are looking so beautiful with our graphic poster and videos, thanks to your creativity as well. So we really have to say that also the Disruption Network Lab looks so cool because of Jonas. And the Tabea Hamper that work with the press of the Deep Cables events and the Ignorance event. And Elise, yeah, let's, of course, she's also not here, I think, but another email that we will send to her. And of course, also that they are here, Elisabeth Enke and Silvio Frank, that also is helping us with the technology. Elisabeth is there all the time, taking care of our technology sounds and the importance of speaking out for us as well. And the wonderful video team, the Rosso crew of Gonzalo, Angel, and I am really bad with the name. Gabriel, sorry, yeah. Oh no, I don't remember that. Okay, sorry, my mistake for names. Thank you, because you are really also central for our documentation, and you do really wonderful video for us. So thank you, the Rosso film. And Maria Silvano, that is sitting over there for our photography. And finally, I want to thank Christian Diaz, Max Frankes, and Jill Sieber for helping us building up the space, and also Helen Aknor and Antonia Heikenaure for the cash desk. And finally, as every year, the anonymous Gabriel, that we don't say who is. So this is all the thanks. This also shows that we are a lot of people. We put a lot of effort here. We want to come back next year. Let's hope they give a lot of money to us. Still, is a still we don't know, but it's like the old story of every November and December. And thanks a lot for being here. To everybody, all the speakers and the public.
And of course, thank you, Tatiana, for doing this, for bringing all your thoughts, ideas, wisdom, knowledge, contacts, people in here. It's great to be part of this and to have these events and to make up our minds about what's happening out there and that it's important. Thank you for that.
Thanks. And now we can go to eat pizza and show that in Berlin is better than in Sweden.